Welcome. This is our session, Often Overlooked XProtect Features, Part 4. So we've done this at previous MIPS events, and we're doing a recording today, and we're going to try to keep that same feeling, that live on stage feeling of us going through the features kind of live and working through it. So my name is Jason Wallace.
And I'm Alex Lafrenier.
And we are on screen now, so we're going to be your virtual hosts at the bottom of the screen here as we go through our various features and capabilities of the software. So our agenda, the introduction, got that out of the way, and our agenda is there's really no real agenda. We're just going to throw a bunch of useful XProtect features, tips, and tricks at you and hope that you find some useful nuggets from this and have some interesting things to make your life easier within XProtect.
Now, we are going to run through these things relatively quickly. That is because we know this is a recorded session. So you will have that option to be able to pause, rewind, playback, and go through all of these items that we're looking at. This allows us to get more of these items out to you in a bit of a shorter time frame.
Pause is your friend. So to start out with here, first thing we want to talk about is the idea of logging into multiple sites at the same time. So a lot of people assume that you need interconnect or federated architecture if you want to be able to be simultaneously logged into several different separate milestone sites simultaneously or at the same time. You don't have to do that. Just like you can have two Microsoft Word documents open at once, so too can you double-click the Smart Client icon, launch a second instance, and just log into a secondary location at the same time. The only exception to that would be is, say you needed cameras from two different facilities or two different separate systems in the exact same window, at the exact same layout, at the exact same time. Okay, yeah, you're going to need interconnect or federated. But you know, if you don't mind double-clicking a second time, logging into that second site, and just having them exist in two different windows, there's nothing stopping you from logging into two, three, four, five sites all at once, throwing them on different monitors, or having them all exist in the same space. Totally doable. All right, so next up is going to be the ability to click and drag cameras. We call that tile swapping. A lot of people don't realize you don't actually have to drag the camera from that left-hand column all the way over into Smart Client every time you want to rearrange cameras. There's a neat little trick you can do that just lets you swap the cameras around within the Milestone software itself.
Yeah, so this is going to be very handy when you're trying to just adjust a view, even for a temporary basis. While you're sitting in live view, you can grab the camera, not from anywhere on the screen because you go into digital PTZ, but you can grab the camera basically by where the title is, that black area above, and swap it over. So drag and drop, and those cameras will now adjust position. And you can do that for any camera on your view. Now, if you are zoomed in for any reason or moving around in the view, double clicking to go full screen or swapping from here could adjust what you're looking at. So doing it from this title up above, double click for full screen or swapping is a very quick and easy way to adjust a temporary view. What that means, if I reset my view, it's going to be back to the way it was originally. If you do the same functionality, but while setup mode is turned on, you will save those settings. So again, quickly altering a view so that it lines up however you want it to be, then uncheck setup. Now this is going to be the way your view works going forward.
Absolutely. So next up, we have camera tiles are not just for cameras. So a lot of people assume that all the tiles are for is for holding cameras. Now, if you've ever made a map in Milestone, you know that you can put other stuff in those tiles like a map, but you can also load pictures or text or an HTML web page into it. So we have the ability, you know, built into the software to be able to load an HTML web page, but a little spoiler for something we're going to show you later on with Access Optimizer, it takes it a little bit of a step further and lets you reference a text file on your computer to load the appropriate HTML code into that camera tile. My favorite feature or favorite use for this is to put a little weather bug up at the top of the corner so you can kind of get an idea of your current conditions.
So we'll quickly show you how to do that. I've got a quick tile here, a view, but I have one tile that's ready to use. So we're going to head on to this website. It is called weatherwidget.io. This allows you to generate code for very basic weather widgets. The first thing I'm going to do is enter the location, and we'll go with our head office in Portland, Oregon. Let it find that location. And now this view, the way that this is showing here, doesn't work for me. So I'll just minimize that to roughly the size of the tile that I have. Then click Get Code. This will generate the code. Now you don't have to edit it. You don't have to modify it. You don't even have to start a website. Simply grab this code, paste that into a notepad, And now we're going to save this as an HTML file. Fastest way to do that, put the name in quotes, and we'll just call this weather.html quote. That will save to the desktop. And we've actually now written that. So now we go into setup. We'll use the Access Optimizer web view, drag it into that screen, and then browse for that page that we just created. That's going to be on the desktop called weather.html. Click open, OK, get out of setup mode, and now we actually have a dynamically updated weather report for the area.
Yep, and it is an interactive web page. If you click on it, it actually opens a new window. It treats it as though it's a little micro web browser in that tile. So another interesting use for this is not just for showing a weather widget, but a lot of people have automation tools or access control systems or building occupancy systems that are HTML-based. So you could actually use that tile or any of the tiles in the layout to show current building occupancy, that sort of thing. So anything that uses an HTML web-based interface, you can throw into these tiles and increase that functionality without having to code a single thing or do anything in the SDK. It's kind of a neat little add-on there.
And we're going to add in one more item, not really HTML related, but just something that gets brought up quite a bit. And it's something a lot of people don't know. In this weather tile, I have this lower section that brings up all the additional functionality. Now, in a camera, you've got a few other things, independent playback, bookmarking, and so on. This tile, this is relatively useless. I can zoom in, I can send to a printer, not needed. But it will come up every time that I enter that screen. So if we just hit setup, click that down chevron, and then click setup again, it's only going to show that chevron, and it's not going to show the rest of it. So this is a way to eliminate those additional functions if for that particular camera stream or any other element that you put in, that tile is or that section is not needed. You can just keep it out of the way permanently.
So next up, what do we have? We have text is cut off in the management client. So have you ever launched the management client and you have a hard time navigating because the text is all sort of truncated? No matter how you drag this column, you know, left or right, the text just doesn't come back. And it kind of makes life a little bit difficult for getting around within the management client software. So there is a good reason it does this. It has to do with the text scaling in Microsoft Windows. So if you right click on the desktop, you say display properties, scroll down a little bit, you'll see where it has text scaling. A lot of times it'll default to 125 or 150%, depending on your monitor size and what Windows wants to do. You can change this to 100%. It'll fix the problem. But the issue is if you have a high resolution monitor, all your icons
or
and text.
Low resolution eyes.
Yeah, or low resolution eyes. Your text will end up being very small on the screen. So that's going to be an issue. Sometimes you really need this feature. So the quick fix for it, I'm just going to show you the slide real quick if you want to pause for it, but we'll actually run through it live, is to go into the properties for that shortcut and to make some changes there.
All right, and we'll just quickly walk you through that. So on my desktop, there's the shortcut for the management server. Right click on that, head down to properties. In this new property section, look for the tab called compatibility, change high DPI settings, and then there's that checkbox there that you can see I'm already using. It will override that DPI setting for the application. So only affects management client, will not affect anything else you're using on that PC.
Yeah, so usually that box would not be checked. You would want to go in and check that box, and that's going to resolve the problem for you without having to change that desktop scaling. So next up, keyboard shortcuts. All right, so this is an oldie but a goodie. We show these, we show this one every year, but it really is worthy of repetition. We really need people to understand about this feature and how to be able to use this because it saves a tremendous amount of time. So this is the ability to map almost any function in the Smart Client software to a quick keyboard command, whatever you want to define for that feature. Our favorite one, if you scroll down, is and we'll show you how to do it, is called reload server configuration. I'm a big control R guy because it makes sense for me. For R for reload, you hit that and it'll basically be the equivalent of logging out and logging back in.
Yeah. And for everybody else who is now smashing the keyboard watching this, when he said control R, the correct answer is F5 for refresh.
The debate rages.
All right, so we'll actually see that here. I've already got it set up correctly with F5, but you'll find it under application. And then just a little bit scroll down, you'll see reload server configuration. And there it is as a global command F5. Now, as I mentioned, we will need this as we go through a few more. So it's always a good idea to have this set up.
Yeah, when you set it up, all you have to do is just select it, hit the little keyboard area there, and actually put in the keyboard command you want, and then hit assign, and it pushes it through. So yeah, we will be revisiting this one here shortly. So this one is definitely one you want to set up for sure. So back over here. So our next thing we're going to show you has to do also with keyboard shortcuts, but it's a little bit different take on it. So this is the ability to map keyboard shortcuts, specifically around the number pad, to quickly call up cameras or change views if you want to. So this is not mapping particular features, but is a way to navigate the interface and to switch views, switch cameras without having to click and drag stuff or use the mouse too much. Once you get good with this, you can really rapidly navigate the interface quickly. It involves two different areas where you want to set it up. First, the area you set this up is within the management client. This is where you define what cameras are going to have what numbers associated with it. So if you want to name a camera number one and you want to call that camera up, you can hit, you know, /1 or *1 to change these modes around. That's where you define that. We do that because camera configuration is always done in the management client. The second area is within the Smart Client software itself. And that's where you can define specifically around your layouts. So if you want to change your layouts, and we do it that way because layouts are always made in the Smart Client software. So that's what that shortcut feature is. So if you've ever wondered what these shortcut features do within Milestone, this is where you can set that stuff up.
Yeah, so we'll start off with the camera side. And this is for calling up cameras quickly. So where you'll find that is under the camera section, select the camera that you want to use, and then you're going to go to that client tab. That is then going to have an empty shortcut option. This is where you will enter that in. So I'll just give this a shortcut of 11, and maybe the second garage, second level will be 22. So these are quick, easy shortcuts that I can use, and then I can use them now in live or in the Smart Client once I've reloaded my configuration. Told you that was going to be useful. So since we're here now in the Smart Client, I will simply hit F5.
Or Control R.
Well, moving on. So what we can now do is highlight those cameras as needed. So from this section here, with /11 enter, I can bring up those camera views. And I don't have to click and move, actually. As may have seen on screen, 8, 4, 2, and 6 will allow me to move through these camera views. So I can now go set up the next view here and very quickly, temporarily, update my camera views. Now, as we noted before, these are never permanent unless you're in setup mode. So we'll actually reset this and go into setup mode for the other setting for keyboard shortcuts that we can use. That's going to be isolated here. Sorry?
No, I was going to say, and the 8426, I didn't mention that earlier, but think of those like arrow keys. So it's not a code that you're typing in for that. That's how you can change your selection around, kind of like hitting the arrow keys to move around and navigate. So if you quickly need to move over, you can use 8 to go up, 2 to go down, 4 to go left, et cetera.
Yeah. So the other shortcuts that we have here are right next to the camera view. So I've called this demo 147, demo 258. But then using this section here at the bottom under shortcut, I simply enter that number, hit set, and now you can see it in parentheses to the left. That lets me know that that view is now also set up in quick shortcuts. So when I'm not in setup mode, *456 will take me to a view that doesn't exist because it has not been assigned, but *147 will, and we'll see that I'll now move up to a new view. So star will change the views, will change the cameras themselves. But important note, this only works on a number pad. Unfortunately, you can't use the numbers up above the keyboard in order to do this. This is number pad functionality only.
And I believe it's /enter will reset the camera, or /enter is the equivalent of hitting that little button up at the top to reset your view, basically set the view back to its default setting from the
server. And that's correct. There are a few other ones like that. Enter will simply go to full screen. Mm-hmm. /enter or // will then do other things. This one's already been reset, so we see nothing happening.
Yep. So we mentioned earlier, double clicking goes full screen. That's another little cheat. If you hit enter, that also takes you full screen too. So you can avoid using the mouse and just navigate with the keypad. Saves a lot of time if you get good with it. So next up, we have video diagnostic overlay. So this is the ability to call up a diagnostic overlay for what's going on in terms of your video streams coming in. It's unique to each tile. This is another one that we show every year, but it's really an oldie but a goodie. It's something you really need to know about it saves a tremendous amount of time with troubleshooting stuff. So specifically over here, you can change the different levels to show more information. I usually just go straight to level 3 so I can get all the goodies from it, but it'll show you your frame rate. It's very common to see that fluctuating frames per second moving around. If it's not moving, there's actually something wrong with your system. You expect to see that kind of fluctuating. Next, we have our codec. We have our resolution. This will be important later on in a subsequent slide. What hardware acceleration you're using, whether it's Intel or perhaps NVIDIA acceleration. It'll load balance between those and give you an idea of what's actually being used. You can even see your group of pictures, which is your keyframe rate. So if you're doing 30 frames per second and you see your group of pictures is 30, that means you're getting one. You know, every 30 frames is a keyframe coming in. Really useful information. And in particular, also seeing what the camera bit rate is, what the true bit rate is that's coming into your smart client session.
Yeah, now one important thing to note is we've gone ahead and now have added this into the web interface as well. So if you're using the thin client, you can now go to settings, scroll down, and turn video diagnostic overlay on. A very good reason why is because we did introduce both direct streaming and transcoding on the web interface. So we'll now be able to see what frames we're receiving, what codec, and how we're getting it, and at what resolution. Right now, this is limited just to the one level, but we can now get that information in mobile. Okay, but we're going to show it here as well. Now, I've already turned it on, and it's exactly where Jason mentioned, in the settings under advanced. We're going to look at that closely. But this is going to move us into the next topic that we want to cover. And we'll jump to the slide first.
Indeed.
And come right back to this.
So this is our next chip. This is adaptive streaming. This is the idea where you can have multiple streams set up on a camera. It's very common for people to be able to set up a secondary or third or fourth or fifth stream from a camera. And typically the strategy they'll use is they'll have the full resolution for stream one, and they'll progressively get lower resolutions for the alternate streams. The idea being that you can pull the stream that best matches the layout that you're going to show on screen. So if you've got a small postage stamp size area on screen, you don't need 3 megapixels for that. It's going to throw away 90% of the pixels. Why waste the bandwidth and the CPU power to process that? Have the system automatically choose the correct or the most appropriate alternate stream.
Yeah, and it's very easily demonstrated here. And even though this was added to the product within a couple of versions, it's important to know it's not enabled by default. It is something that you do need to turn on. And there is a little bit of configuration with setting up the multiple streams, but most of us using Milestone are already doing that. At minimum, a record stream and a live preview. Now, I have a 5 megapixel camera here, but I am only displaying to live at 320 by 180, which is great for this small camera up in the top right corner. But unfortunately, when we make it larger or attempt to zoom in, the image quality becomes absolutely useless. Now, instead of manually switching, what I'm gonna do is go back into my settings, go to advanced, and I'm going to turn on adaptive streaming. Now, if you are only enabling this per workstation, this is where you would do it. So once that is now enabled, you may have seen an immediate decrease in the background. My top right corner still streaming at 320 by 180. Next size is now 640 by 360. And now because I've digitally zoomed in, we're now at the full 3072 by 1728 for this camera, and you can see that there is a drastic increase in image quality. It will manage what your screen real estate is. So as I zoom out, full 5 megapixels is no longer needed. So it's now dropped down to 1280 by 720, and it's also reduced my frame rate to 8 frames a second. As soon as I zoom in, my record rate is 30 frames, so we're back up to 30 frames a second. This allows to automatically manage what streams each client is getting based on the screen size that they're allotting to it, and so that we can better manage bandwidth and resources on that workstation.
But keep in mind, you're still always recording. You can pick whatever one you want, but typically you're still always going to be recording that primary stream. So even though you may be displaying it at 720 or 320 by 180, you're still in the background recording the good one. So if you need to do playback, you haven't lost anything. This is purely about live streaming and being able to pick the most appropriate stream for bandwidth savings and resource savings on the computer.
Yeah, that's an excellent point.
So the next thing we're going to talk about here is smart client profiles. So this is the ability to designate settings within the Smart Client software itself. So again, this doesn't have to do with roles or permissions. This is specifically around the Smart Client application changing its appearance. Some common uses for this, people sometimes say, well, I've got a kind of an inexperienced operator. There's a lot of activity on the screen here. It's kind of confusing. Well, you can use Smart Client profiles to eliminate a lot of those tabs and the parts of the interface that power users really like, but an inexperienced user may find confusing. You can give them a simplified interface. Some other things that I'll always do when I set up a new system is go in and make a few changes, specifically around default image quality, default frame rate. I'll go ahead and switch over to the display while Alex can show us these here at the same time. But default image quality, default frame rate, that's an area where you can kind of get into trouble. If you have these set to anything other than full and unlimited, it can initiate transcoding on the server side, use a lot of horsepower you don't want to sacrifice. Always lock those down to keep people out of trouble. You can specify an export location specifically. And there's another area where if you're doing exports, there's an option down there at the bottom that says export still images. On that one, it will export a still image for every single frame of video that you're trying to export. If you accidentally choose that option, you can end up with like 10,000 JPEGs in a folder. It's a mess to deal with. There are certain uses for it if you're going to do like time lapse or something like that, but most of the time people never need that feature. I'll switch it to unavailable as he's got it set there, lock it out so that way people can't get into trouble.
So as we saw in the Smart Client, if you're making a change on a per workstation standpoint, that's where you would do it. This is where if you want to make sure all of the Smart Clients are behaving rather similarly. So the advanced one here is where I'll find not only diagnostic overlay, but also that adaptive streaming option. And as you can see, it's been disabled. So I'll go ahead and enable it and actually lock it in place. I'm going to do the same thing for hardware acceleration as well. So that in cases where we're updating or adding these clients, this will take advantage of hardware acceleration and adaptive streaming without any additional intervention on my part. If the workstation has a GPU that we can utilize, it will. If it doesn't, it simply won't.
Yeah, and hardware acceleration is on by default or set to auto by default, but somebody could turn it off. This is a way to kind of keep them out of trouble and make sure their machine is running optimally. So next up, we have camera search by keyword. So this is a little confusing because you've got your camera names, right? So if you've named the camera library, you can always search in the Smart Client for the term library and bring that camera up. But people don't tend to name their cameras with a whole variety of descriptive terms. So wouldn't it be nice if you were able to, let's say you had an incident at Fifth and Main, to be able to just type in Fifth and Main. You may not have your cameras all named Fifth and Main. You may have one on a building or one down a street or one in a park, but maybe in the proximity of that Fifth and Main location. So by using the description field, that field is indexed for search. Even though it doesn't show up in the Smart Client, you can search by those terms. So if you put a variety of important keywords that pertain to a camera in that field, not only does it help your operator know, you know, if they're in the management client, where that camera is and what it's about, but it also gives you a really powerful ability to search and create dynamic layouts based on those keywords.
Yeah. So an example of that, in the camera section on the info tab, we'll see that description field. And I just started entering ways to describe doors. So door, doors, entrance, in this case, loading or dock for the receiving door. And then same thing for anywhere that there's parking. I've just added the word parking, regardless if it's in the title. So we'll actually see how that functions over in the Smart Client. So I'll jump into that now. And we'll go over here into our search camera views. So this allows me to search for the word door. And you can see I don't have any views, but I do have three cameras with the word door in that area. So I can select these cameras individually and just view those doors. Now, a very interesting thing that you can do, I'm going to do it with the word parking. I've now see five cameras that have set up, but I don't have all five of these in one view. So let's go ahead and create a view. A very cool way to do that, click the first camera, holding down shift, click the last camera. Now, right from here, all we want to do is hit enter. Now, this is going to create what Jason refers to as an Insta layout. So all five views have been brought up into a stream or into a view, and it's ready for use. But again, as mentioned earlier, we're not in setup mode, so this is temporary. The way to make this a permanent view, go into setup mode, hide my search, and we'll see temporary search, and then this view has been called search. If I select it, Control C, go back into my group, and Control V, that search has now been added. what I'll do is I'll just rename this parking. And just because we've just learned it, I'm going to go ahead and give this a shortcut code 456. Now that I unclick setup, it's ready to go and ready for use.
And that temporary view is temporary. If you click away from it, that search result will disappear. So you want to, if you're going to make a permanent layout out of this, you do want to make sure that you select it and do the Control C, Control V first. And you have to use the keyboard commands. They've got it grayed out where you can't right click on it, new copy. But the keyboard commands, you know, again, Control C, Control V is the secret handshake to make it work.
All right.
All right. So next up, we have update on motion, and we're kind of covering the frame. So let's get rid of us. There we go. So this is the ability to have camera streams activate when motion is being detected on screen. So the idea behind this is a lot of times people will make these 25, 50, 100 camera layouts. Looks really great for a photo, but the human brain just isn't wired to be able to deal with processing and catching information. When you've got that much activity on screen, that many different places, it just doesn't work. You end up missing 70-80% of the activity on screen. So this is a means of not only saving resources on the computer in terms of bandwidth and processing power, but also being able to draw an operator's attention to specific frames, specific video tiles that begin experiencing motion.
Yeah. Now, tips and tricks to me has always been kind of the idea of that missing checkbox that we forgot about and can't find ever again. This is one of those cases where that checkbox is actually true. It is simply one checkbox. So in the Smart Client, click Setup, then scroll down and find that checkbox called Update on Motion. When I check it, it applies to just this one video feed, and that may be all that I need. But I can also do Apply to All, and now apply this setting to all video feeds. When I come back out of setup, you'll actually see it's connected, but no motion. And then as motion propagates through those streams, they will then become available to the live viewer, the operator, in order to draw their mind or their eye to exactly what they need to be paying attention to.
Yeah. So in this particular instance, it doesn't look like we have any. There it goes. It lights up one. So we had a moment where we didn't have anything going on. But then as these cameras detect motion, it's going to draw your eye to the various cameras as they light up when motion activity occurs on the screen. That's also just to point out, this does not interfere with your recording. So if you are, for example, recording 24/7, you still have motion detection turned on. You can still use this feature and it doesn't stop your recordings. Your camera would continue recording in the background, but still this feature would work correctly within the Smart Client software.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
So next up, PowerShell. All right, so this is one of those tips and tricks that is a really, really powerful, powerful feature. This is kind of this is a class 101. This is tips and tricks 201 or 501 class level here. All right, so this is going to take a little time to set up if you want to do it. It's not a major heavy lift, but you got to do a little bit of effort to set up the PowerShell, load the tools, that kind of thing. But imagine being able to import cameras as a CSV file. So if you want to pre-stage a system and load cameras into it in advance, you can do that. What if you wanted to, if you want to change a camera name, that takes a few seconds, no problem. But what if you need to change 500 camera names? That's going to take some time. It's going to kind of be a little tedious to go through 500 cameras and change those names. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to export a list, change all the names in Excel, bring that list back into it, and have a bulk change like that? There's a variety of really cool, useful tools you can do within PowerShell for this type of thing. We were going to give you a really long URL to access where these tools live, but yeah, we all use Google. Here's a quicker way to do it. Just Google milestone space PowerShell. That's going to bring you to our developer page where we cover this stuff, or Google GitHub milestone PowerShell. And in there, you'll find a really really updated whole variety of the step-by-step instructions on how to go through this stuff.
Yeah, so I went over to GitHub and I've actually grabbed one of the more recent ones, which is a Get Camera Report. And it's now cycling through every camera that I have on my recording servers, regardless of their current status. And it's actually going to run through it and run a test connection. So it's going to ping it essentially, come back with information and generate a camera report. Now, you can send this out to a CSV file if that's all you need for it to do. Or what you'll actually see, they've added in an option in order to output this directly to a grid so that it shows up on the screen. Now, we'll let that run in the background, but I'll just show you that website that I did have open. This is where you can grab that. This is the GitHub site. and you just go into samples, and you'll see a lot of options and samples here on what you can do and which reports you can grab. And of course, once you've got it, you can feel free to modify it as you need. But here's that example. We've actually created this report, and it's gone through all of my different cameras, identified which ones are not currently responding, and then also spit out all of the additional information. When it was modified, what the IDs, the hardware names, the recording servers that they're attached to, model, driver, address, username, and so on. So you can actually run this to include the password. Of course, being my system, I've opted to leave that off for this demonstration.
And another important tip, when you're on the GitHub site, as you first log into it, there is a README at the top level on there. Do read the README. So this isn't a major lift to get set up. If you follow the instructions, it's really pretty painless and gives you just some remarkably powerful capabilities to directly interact with the SDK using PowerShell and to really do some really incredible stuff within the software. But there's a couple little pitfalls, some tricks, like, for example, you need to change the encryption mode of your system for it to load the PowerShell tools or the libraries correctly. The README will walk you through it step by step. So do read the README.
There's a reason why it's in all caps.
So next up, we have add Smart Client Installer to the server. So what does this mean? Well, first off, in the past, we used to have a variety, we released two Smart Client installers every time we had a new release. There was a server-side installer, and there was the regular installer. And frankly, nobody ever really understood why we had a server-side installer. What was that for? So they ended up getting rid of it, but there was a really good reason for it, and we didn't lose that functionality. There's still a way to use this. So everybody should know about the ability to go into the HTML interface if you need to download the additional servers. So if you need to add a new recording server or you need to add a new mobile server to the system, there's that page, that installation/admin, where you give the address of your management server /installation/admin to grab those tools and download them directly from the management server. We've also got in that first tab the ability to download the Smart Client. So that one is your management server address /installation brings up that page. But what if you have, say, a 32-bit client you need to add to it? You want to add additional downloads into this page.
Yeah, so what I've done is I've gone ahead and downloaded from the website the 32-bit installer for the Smart Client for 2020R3. So we want to add it to this site so that I'm not just handing out this file or setting it up in a repository. I can utilize the same file repository that is basically created with the management client or the management server. So what we're going to do first is take this installer and create a shortcut. So we'll right-click Send To, create a shortcut. Now we have that here. Right-click on this, and we're going to modify the properties. So right-click Properties. Under Target, we're going to add something to the end of that. Go all the way to the right, and we're going to add space, --ss, _, and then registration. Once we apply that, we'll actually watch this work. And when I run the shortcut, it'll unpack. You may even see some files show up here on the desktop. Looks like it happened too fast. You didn't see it, but now we're done. So we did not install it, but if I refresh the download page, the 32-bit installer has now been added and it's ready for use throughout the organization.
Yeah, so the 32-bit, not many people have 32-bit systems left anymore, but other applications might be if you have an older version of the Smart Client servers, but you want to use the newer Smart Client that may have been released with a subsequent release. This is a convenient way you can add the Smart Client installer for a newer release onto your older Milestone system.
And that's an excellent point to, as we update and add those hot fixes or the patches to each subsequent release, update them here as well so that you don't have to run those updates later on. You can just update the installer centrally.
Absolutely. All right, so next up, we're going to have interesting third-party software specifically around the Access Optimizer. So this is a really cool thing, a really good example of a technology partner that's done a deep integration into Milestone and brought in some really powerful functionality, but it's not all specifically just around Access cameras. So this also gives us the ability to do things like dewarping. So they have, you know, fisheye cameras for Access, but they've got it unlocked where it can be used on other cameras as well. So we have an interesting dewarping engine you can use from Access, and they also also have that little HTML feature that we spoiled earlier, where you can drag an HTML web page or use an HTML web page within a Canva layout. Now, we have that feature also, but the Access Optimizer version of it gives you that browse tool where we could do a little custom snippet of code and load in that weather widget that we demonstrated.
Yeah. Now, the few things I want to walk through very quickly are what they've done recently inside the management client. One of the best ones is under Access Optimizer Device Assistant. This will allow you to go into the embedded web client of each individual Access camera that you have on your Milestone system, and all of the usernames and passwords are already saved with the configuration. So this will let you jump directly into it without having to go log in or do anything else above and beyond that, make changes to the camera that you normally couldn't do without logging directly in. Another section that I think is great is all those tools that, or some of the tools that Jason may have mentioned, you now have permission around them. So not only in between WebViewer and DWARP, but when you look at a camera specifically, you'll get additional functionality on many PTZs, the ability to set the focus, and on other cameras, other features. Going into this Access Optimizer security, and when this is enabled, you'll actually be able to go into your roles, find a new section for Optimizer, and then go through and choose which role is allowed to make or modify changes, including utilize Optimizer in management client. So this will allow you to really harden down which tools can be made available and keep it within Milestone permission sets.
Yeah, within that device assistant, anything you could do in the normal Access firmware, you can still do within our management client now. That includes updating firmware or even setting up the analytics within a camera, having direct access to that that HTML interface. It's really slick integration that they've done.
Yeah. And the last thing I want to make sure everybody's aware of, because it hides at the end of the list, is they've added options into our rules engine. So they'll be able to run operator controls, activate or deactivate radar, start door station calls, or dry the camera using that shaggy wet dog technique to shake the camera. These are now all actions that can be automated and adhere to any previous rules or time profiles that you've got set up within Milestone. These are now new events that could be triggered via the Milestone rule engine.
Yep. And where you get this from, it is something that Access has written for Milestone. It's a plugin. You can grab that right off the Access website. You can go in there and you'll find Access Optimizer for XProtect off the Access website. Okay. And that kind of brings us to the end. So we want to thank you for attending our session and hope that you guys have a great day.
Yeah. Have a great day, everyone.